Hachette Audio presents Carry On, Reflections for a New Generation. Written by John Lewis with Kabir, Sehgal. Read by Don Cheadle. Foreword, written and read by Ambassador Andrew Young. Afterword, written and read by Kabir, Sehgal.
Foreword by Ambassador Andrew Young. One of the reasons that I came back to the South from New York, where I was working with the National Council of Churches, was the Nashville sit-in story in 1960. And there was John Lewis leading it. He was persuasive and powerful even back then. But there was a certain power in his humility that you were not really prepared for. He had such a sweet spirit about him, and it was magnetic. I remember in 1960 being on the Fisk University campus, and there was one group of about 10 students led by John Lewis, and they were preparing to leave the campus, and I asked a fellow student, "Where are they going?" And he responded, "Oh, that's John Lewis, and he's going to test one of the last restaurants that we have not been able to desegregate." It was like he ignored everything about college life and focused on desegregation. And then he got to be elected president of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC, in 1963. There were all of these firebrand types who were competing for leadership, and nobody could agree on them. But then they all could agree on John Lewis. And when I asked why, they said, "He was so humble, but he was also the most courageous." I watched him grow through those years, but he never changed. I knew John for 60 years, and we were always close, but we didn't always agree on everything. He was very stubborn and determined. For example, when I was the mayor of Atlanta, and John was on the city council, I was trying to build about 400 new roads because the city was expanding so quickly, including the Presidential Parkway and Freedom Parkway. They seemed like absolute necessities for the growing metropolis and the traffic that it was generating. And I was catching hell all over the city, trying to put together the votes in favor of these roads. But I could never get John's vote because he had made a promise to his constituents that he would never vote for more roads, and he always kept his word. He was unwavering in his determination once he set his course. Now, I thought he was wrong on that, and still do. So almost to get even, we named the Freedom Parkway the John Lewis Freedom Parkway. And now we're trying to name one of the buildings at Georgia State for him, because if there's one thing that's missing in American education, there's almost no concept of humility and courage. And John Lewis embodies both. In fact, humility could be the title of this book. You should know about John Lewis' simple determination and single-mindedness. There's a book that I read in seminary by Søren Kierkegaard, the Danish theologian, and the title of it was Purity of Heart. And purity of heart is to will one thing. And that was the way John Lewis dealt with any issue. He focused on whatever was absolutely and spiritually essential. And he didn't care whether it was popular. He didn't care what was political. He didn't care that the majority might or might not think it right, because the majority of black students and leaders in Nashville didn't particularly agree on the sit-ins when they started. But that didn't deter John. And in the 1965 march from Selma to Montgomery, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee voted not to participate. They were playing movement politics, sort of, and the ego politics, but that didn't deter John. He said, "I'm marching not as the chairman of SNCC, but I'm marching as John Lewis, and I'm a citizen of Alabama, and I'm going to make that march." He ended up leading it with Hosea Williams, another prominent civil rights leader and activist from Savannah, Georgia. When John was an early teenager, he sent a letter to Martin Luther King, who answered him and sent him money for a bus ticket to come to Montgomery to visit his church. And Martin took him home to dinner after that church service. And that was how impressive a kid he was. He was known by Martin as the boy from Troy. And that's how Martin and John met. Two giants of the civil rights movement in their early years, before any of us knew who either of them were. I never knew John to show anger or frustration. John had the kind of purity of heart that Kierkegaard described, and he had it since he was a teenager. Throughout his life, he remained the same, innocent, dedicated, visionary child who went to see Martin Luther King. He was the same in Congress. He would go to anybody's congressional district and draw a crowd. Everybody wanted to meet him because everybody wanted to meet one good man. And John Lewis was one good man. The basis of his power in Congress was that he was able to get anybody reelected. It's 5% difference between almost 75% of the congressional seats. And a visit from John Lewis in a community that was 10, 20% black could increase the voter turnout and help almost anybody get elected. And John was willing to spend his weekends and go campaign with Democrats and even Republicans if they were the kind of people that he believed in. He was one of the people in Congress that everybody admired and respected because he was as close to a saint as they'd ever seen in Washington. He was more like the Dalai Lama or Gandhi than a politician. And when he wasn't helping people, he was reading his Bible because he always wanted to be a preacher. And in many ways, he was a preacher. It was spiritual with John, and it was a magnetic spirituality that drew people to him. You'd rarely hear him laugh out loud. His laugh was very guarded, but he always had a twinkle in his eye, and he always seemed to be very, very happy. He wasn't in any way argumentative or aggressive. It was almost like he thrived on lacking an aggressive personality. His humility and courage were magnetic. They drew you to him. And yet he wasn't all righteous. He didn't expect you to be like him. He had a sense of duty and a sense of responsibility and discipline. In my generation, the generation of John Lewis and Martin Luther King, we were taught that to lead a movement, there was no compromising on any principle, and that it was important to forgive because you can't receive forgiveness yourself if you can't forgive others. And we had to work on that pretty hard, especially to forgive people who bombed churches with four little girls in Sunday school or who murdered Martin Luther King. But we never lost hope. And John never did. One of the musts in the movement was that whenever there was someone killed, you have to continue his work. Otherwise, you send a message that killing a leader will stop the movement. And whenever somebody was killed, you've got to replace him with 8 or 10, 20 or even 100. And so we were duty-bound to have another march in Memphis and to go to Washington for the Poor People's Campaign in 1968, even knowing that it might not succeed, probably would not succeed. We were going there knowing that we would get tear gas or worse. John knew. You've seen those images of John. Like you see images today, John would say to you, don't give up, don't lose hope, be patient and persevere. Change will come. Just read the following pages of wisdom by John. In his words, these pages embody the John Lewis that I knew from the beginning, and he remained true to himself, pure, simple, real, humble. John was just a rare bird, down to the smallest detail. I think, even in the days of the movement, when he was leading a march, everybody else might have on blue jeans, and we were about to be tear gassed, but John was in a suit. As I write this, COVID and social injustice have certainly humbled the most powerful nation on the face of the earth. No other nation could defeat us in a war, or in business, or in peacemaking, or in anything else. But these two plagues have brought us all to our knees. Falling back on Scripture, be still and know that I am God. Psalm 46, verse 10. We forget who the Lord of the universe is, and this is our Father's world, and it does not belong to us. We're going to have to change the way we face life and think about it. And I hope that you find your generation's John Lewis. And this is a time when we need many with the spirit of John Lewis, because there's a lot to do. I know that right up to the end, John remained dedicated in that effort. It was in his blood and soul. He was saving his energy to try to make a vote in Congress for the 2020 elections. He was determined to keep his eyes on the prize for all of you, and he wouldn't allow himself to be distracted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.